So
I'm ready to
this
start.
does this include our new batch also, the ones that started this year?
Yeah, most of them are like we circulated the Google form asking for their questions. So most of them are registered were the students from first year only,
Okay,
freshers.
that's great. So
Okay.
these guys haven't got the chance to be on campus, right?
No, not yet.
That's actually
Only
sad.
virtually.
Yeah. So how is your online classes and all going?
Online classes are going pretty good
Okay.
from morning till evening. And like they have now made compulsory for opening video also.
Okay.
So now each student have to sit in front of the camera for the attendance issue.
So you can't sleep while the meeting is going
Yeah.
on, right?
Yeah.
That's great.
Okay. So let's start with the event. So very good evening, everyone. I hope you all are safe and doing well. I extend a warm welcome to all the students and thank you for joining for our event, Bennett Talks. So this side, Daksh Jain, chairperson and founder of Geeks for Geeks Society of Bennett University. And before starting with the session, I would like to tell you more about the society. So we at Geeks for Geeks Society of Bennett University aims to serve as a dynamic hub of activities where everyone meet, interact, and learn from each other. And our society was established 3 months back on 20th July 2020. Until now, we have organized almost 10 plus events. We will be hosting some amazing webinars from industry experts, and we will be organizing fun events, contests, open source drive, and hackathons. So now starting with the event. Today with us, we are this is the very first session of Bennett Talks, and we have a very, very special guest, Nikhil Ramakrishnan Bhaiya, who is the topper of a very first batch of 2016 with 9.77 CGPA. He's currently working in Commvault as a software development engineer. He has cleared GSOC 2 times, one in third year and one in fourth year, and also received Vice Chancellor's Gold Medal for academic performance. In this session, Nikhil Bhaiya will be discussing about his journey of 4 years and how he bagged the 20 lakh package in Commvault. Thank you, Nikhil Bhaiya, for joining. Over to you.
Hi everyone. So this is Nikhil. Many of you might not know me. So I'm from the 2020 batch, which is the first batch that passed out, at least for the engineering. And as of now, I work at Commvault as a software development engineer, like Dux told you. So what I am working on these days is on cloud technologies, including Azure. So Commvault has recently got a partnership with Microsoft. So we are moving a lot of our technology to the cloud. And Azure is, I mean, it has a diverse set of tools that allows us to do that. So that's what my team is working on.
Okay, so that's pretty great, Bhaiya. So, like, I would like to start with a basic question, which is asked from every fresher when he takes admission in Bennett. That why did you took admission in Bennett University? Like.
Okay, so yeah, so at least in my case, this is going to be a interesting answer because when we joined, there was no previous batch. There wasn't even a senior batch that was already studying at Bennett University. So when we joined, Bennett University, as you've seen in photos or in person, was just two buildings, right? So how my decision to join initially came up was, so first thing was that, let's say, we got to know that it was a Times of India venture, so that actually attached something to it. And then later we had multiple webinars with the VC back then, who was Yash Madhuri, Dr. Yash Madhuri. And I thought because these guys were promising and actually giving us full plans of how this infrastructure is going to be, how the professors are going to be picked, and how the curriculum is going to be created in line with how, let's say, Georgia Tech does it. So that was one of the few things that actually attracted me and helped me to choose Bennett University from all the other options I had.
Okay, so that was good to hear. And like, how was your life at Bennett for 4 years?
Well, I'd say it was, I mean, initially it was different than how it was in the last few years because we were the only batch along with a few senior MBAs in the university. So it used to be very empty. At times you could say we felt alone in the university, but you know, as the crowd started increasing, we got to interact with a lot more people. We got to interact with juniors. We actually got to interview people for our clubs and societies, and that's the way we found many more juniors who are interested in many things, who are already having the skill sets that is required to work at a higher level in the clubs. And you know, many of these, even many of you guys have this startup ideas that are coming up, and that actually helped build up a culture around startups and programming and contributing to open source and all these societies that came up. I guess that's all, a product of the kind of students that decided to join the university.
Okay, yeah. So like, as most of the freshers are present in the webinar, so according to you, what should be a roadmap for a student for getting a place in a good product-based company if he is coming to Bennett and with no prior coding experience, no C++?
Okay, so yeah, that's like a very generic question that people ask others who get placed in a product company. But yeah, I would say there is no fixed things that you have to do to actually get placed in a product company, or actually you don't even have to aim to get placed in a product company as such, right? So the first thing you want to do is just don't focus on one thing. Try to explore as much as you can, because right now you're in the first year. Placement should not be your concern at this point. What you have to do is try to gain as much as skills as you want and try to find out what you're interested in. So let's say after the first, second year, you explore a lot of things. You say, I want to join a product company. I want to become a software developer. And of course, you require coding, you require algorithms, you require knowledge of a lot of computer science for it. So once you have made that decision, what I would suggest is, instead of focusing on a programming language and learning that all the way, I would suggest learn algorithms. Learn the core concepts of computer science. So there are things like networking, which has become very important. So networking concepts is important. Mm-hmm. And then there's operating systems, which is also, you would say that operating systems are already there. Why do we need to learn about them? But many of the concepts of operating systems are still used in the more higher level applications. So if you know how an operating system works, you basically know how to optimize your program such that the operating system can handle it in the best way possible. So that's an example I'm giving you. Of course, you could be one of those people developing an operating system. So I guess Kashish will talk to you tomorrow. He's in Microsoft, right? So you could be developing those operating systems for all you know. And then you have all these core concepts of, the main thing that you want to know is algorithms, right? So I'm not saying you want to just know all the data structures, know all the algorithms that go behind them, but once you get an idea of how things work. So start with the basic data structures, go on to trees, graphs, and then so on. And then try to see if you can solve questions. So Geeks for Geeks is a good website to solve a lot of questions. They have so many resources, and many coding tests and interviews actually don't have questions that are not on Geeks for Geeks. So if you actually practice a lot from there, you'll probably not be surprised by what you're getting in the coding test, because you've probably already done that question before, right? So the programming language is actually a way to just explain the computer your algorithm for your problem, for your solution, right? So once you know your core concepts, learning a programming language, believe me, is not at all difficult. So I could give you a simple problem to solve. Let's say that will require an algorithm to get it done. And then I can tell you that you will use a programming language that I have created, and and you don't know the syntax for that, but I'll give you the full documentation reference for the syntax. In this case, if you know what you want to do and how you want to solve the problem, you could just write a pseudocode, just in English, the steps you want to do, and then start going through the documentation to see how you can explain to the compiler what you want to do. So the programming language doesn't matter. All you want to do is focus on the core concepts and keep going. So for the interviews, I would say the best thing you can do is, again, practice the coding problems, and also look at videos of people attempting coding problems in interviews. There is a lot of resources available on that on YouTube, right? So when you do that, you get to see what is the best way to approach. If you know the solution to a problem, let's say the most optimal solution, you just don't go there and say, okay, I know this, here's the solution, I'm done. So if you do that, the interview is just going to go, assume that you know it, and then get to a next question, probably till the time you don't you aren't able to answer. The best way is to start with whatever comes to your mind first, and then they want to see how you approach the problem. So you start with whatever comes to mind, and then you keep on optimizing it till a point where you know, okay, fine, this is what I know, this is the best I can do. And through that process is where your interviewer is looking for, is like how you approach the problem and how you go about solving that problem. Yeah.
Okay, so like according to you, in the first year, a student should focus on the first data structures algorithm concept and then proceed with the development side.
Yeah, so at least, of course, you need to know at least one programming language to understand how those things work. So I guess you're still doing Python in the first year, which is a very good thing because it is a starting place. It is very easy, as simple as writing plain English. And that allows you to basically forget about your programming language jargon and focus on your solution more. So you might see that machine learning problems are very fast to prototype in Python. That is because it provides a lot of libraries and a lot of tools to get it done. So once you have an idea, have a grasp of what Python does, you can move on to start solving, let's say, some data structures. You can start with arrays. Even arrays, people assume that arrays is a very simple thing. It's just elements stored one after another. But if you look at problems that arrays can give you, you will understand that there's a lot more to arrays than you just think there is, right? So just start with arrays, look at problems that involve interview questions that involve arrays, and try to solve them. And if not, don't worry, just you're in the first year, so just look at solutions, look at how people optimize those solutions, and then you can talk about algorithmic theory and all that comes in the second year. So in the first year, I would say just get to know the basics and just get an idea of how these data structures work. Algorithms, you can definitely move in the next 2 years. You have a lot of time there.
Okay, so like I just wanted to tell all the attendees now that at the last, we will be taking all the questions from you guys. For now, we are taking up the questions which were asked in the Google form. So we have selected some of the questions which we will be asking now. And then after that, you can ask in the last 15 to 20 minutes, you can ask your questions. Proceeding with the session, so like once a student is well versed with data structures and side by side have started some development or he's exploring all the fields. So according to you, how should he start preparation for GSOC and when he should start with the open source?
Okay, so that's a good question. So open source, I think most of you have an idea of what open source is. So basically it is a huge community of software developers who contribute code for open software. And most of the base software that your computers, your phones run on today has somehow started out of an open source project, right? So we have to realize how important open source is in our daily life. So of course you can decide not to contribute, but we have to always keep that in mind that most of the software that comes today that you're using is either using open source software or is in itself an open source software. Okay, so coming to the question, when do you start? So it is never too early to start contributing to open source, right? So I have friends that have participated in GSOC in their first year themselves, right? So I did GSOC in my second and third year, so like the summers after the second and third years, and I decided those were the good those times were okay for me because first year vacation I did not want to do anything pretty much, so that's not an issue. Of course, if you are motivated enough to do GSOC, you can always do it in the first year. So some myths I want to clear around GSOC. So it's not a competition, right? So there is no competition as to who finishes first or who does better work. Of course, you are expected to deliver a quality code for your project, but there is no competition between the participants as such. So the selection process of GSOC involves submitting a proposal to your organization that you want to contribute to. So that proposal is actually the only document that will decide whether you are selected, along with any previous communication you've had with the development community that you're submitting to, so the organization. So what I would suggest is, if you can, learn Git, because that is what all of I mean, not, if not all, most of the projects are using as source control. So Git is like, it is very important and it is very useful. Even if you're not trying to participate in GSOC, once you have an idea of Git, especially now that we are working remotely, even our college projects will be done remotely. So if you want to submit a project, you're not going to keep on uploading files to Google Drive and then upload and then updating it and then trying to download and then figuring out which file is the which version is the latest. So if you learn Git, you will realize how convenient it is to collaborate with multiple people, especially people who are not in the same location. So that is the first thing. Once you have an idea of how Git works, you're all ready to like start and jump into an open source project. So what I would suggest is go to GitHub, start a repository, push your own code. It could be anything. It could be a simple bubble sort, merge sort. Just try it out, push it, see if you can pull it, see if others are able to pull it and update it. So that's how you start learning. And once you think you're confident with that, you can explore other repositories that you're interested in. If you're targeting GSOC, you can go to the GSOC website and look at the last, I mean, the previous organizations that have been participating. So many of the organizations participate consistently throughout the years. So if you, let's say you want to participate in GSOC 2021. So in that case, you if you go to 2020 page, you will see many of the organizations, and most of these will be a part of 2021 also. So you pick any one of their repositories, you go into the repository, you try to pull their project, because their readmes will have a build, it'll tell you how to build the project, how to use it. So you try to build it, you try to run it. That's the first step. So that is very simple. It consists of running Git commands and then using their compile command, whatever it is, right? And then once that is done, if you find any obvious bugs, you go to the issues tab and report it. That is the first step to contribution, right? Because contribution does not involve only writing code. It involves documentation, it involves bug reporting, it involves testing also, right? So that is the first step. Once you, let's say, if you don't find any bugs like right away, what you can do is you can go to the issues tab, look at the existing issues. Many of these repositories that participate in GSOC have a good first issue tag, right? So a good first issue is defined as an issue that is good for someone who is just starting out contributing to that repository. So they will basically explain to you everything you want to do in order to solve that issue or in order to solve that bug. So you want to, it's basically like a trial issue. So you want to pull the code, you want to make those changes as described in the issue itself, and then you want to submit a pull request. So once you do all of these, you get to understand how this flow works, right? So how an issue becomes a pull request, how a pull request has approvals, and then how after the approvals, the pull request gets merged into the repository, right? This will also give you an idea of how these automated testing, CI and CDs work, right? So once, I mean, it's not important to know about CIs and CDs as of that time, but you will see those green tick marks saying, okay, this test is passed, this test is passed, you have this linting that is passed. And once that is done, it gets merged. And then you can start a conversation around, okay, so I have done a good first issue. Let me try to look for a better issue. Let me try to look for an issue that involves more work or involves, let's say, editing multiple files or changing, I mean, that requires me to change the logic of some existing code. So you can start interacting with the community well before GSOC. That gives you a kind of a push, right? When you actually submit your proposal for GSOC, because when you submit the proposal, they will know that you've already been a contributor and you have an idea as to how the repository at least works. So they don't expect you to know every line of code or every module in their repository, right? Most of these projects are very large for even a single person to know what is happening around, right? So, but they at least know that you have an idea of how Git works, how their repository works, and how their build system is working to make things like go into their repository and their issue system works, right? Not necessarily GitHub. So many of these projects are on GitHub, GitLab, use their own Git repository hosting service. So that's it. So once you submit your proposal, these guys will have an idea, right? Okay, this is the guy. I already know him from the past few issues or the past few pull requests. And of course, your proposal has to be of good quality. And once that is there, they have this trust that, okay, if, let's say if they have two options, one guy who hasn't contributed, one guy who has contributed before, and both of these proposals are of, let's say, equal quality, right? So this, so these organizations will prefer to select the person who has already contributed because of the simple fact that they know that these people will at least be able to start the project and pull through somehow. So that is how you start contributing. So again, it is never too early. Getting into open source might feel, let's say, scary for some people because you have all these Git things and you have all these so many things to handle other than the actual project, right? But don't rush into it. There are so many tutorials online, how to create a pull request, how to look at issues, how to start with a repository that is simple for beginners, all these things. So just start early. So now it is November. GSOC applications start probably next year in March. So by that time, even if you start now, even if you start next month, you will be able to at least solve a few issues in a few repositories of your interest. So it's not necessary you do it for one. You can go to two, three, or four repositories or organizations of your interest, start contributing. And then when the time comes to submit the proposal, you have this previous experience that you can add to the proposal saying that I have contributed this much. These are the issues I have solved. And that's how you can consider me for the project, right? So that's, yeah. Of course, yeah. Again, first years, I would say you guys should go for it. Even if you are completely not into coding, you can start now because coding is only the syntax. You should know how to solve problems. Otherwise, even if it's a programming language you're not familiar with, just go for it. Submit a proposal. You will learn on the way. There's a lot of time to do that.
So like one student have asked that, what do you mean by proposal? Like first year, don't be having any idea about the proposal. So like, is it your own idea or like we need to work on the provide solution of an existing idea?
Okay. So GSOC is basically, you're working on repositories that already exist. So you're working on projects that are already established or are about to launch, right? So these include even, I mean, core libraries like your Firefox browser, and they go to a lot of different things like your open source space shuttle control programs. So these are there's a very diverse set of projects you can choose from. So the project that you submit a proposal for, they can be of two types. One is every organization puts up an ideas list, right? So once GSOC 2021 organizations are announced, you can go to the GSOC website, you can click on the view ideas list of any organization, and that will take you to a page which shows a list of ideas that the organization has put up for projects. So that is the first way to get through to submit a proposal, because those ideas are already vetted. Those ideas are coming from the people who are probably maintainers of that repository, and they know what they're doing, right? So these are the projects that you will want to select if they're of your interest. And many organizations allow you to submit an idea if it's not on the list. So even if a project idea is not on the list, but you pull the repository, run it, and see that this is a feature that this project could have. So in that case, you can. So these organizations have IRC chat, they have mailing lists, they have a lot of different ways to communicate. So you can go on them, you can go to the chat, you can go to the mailing list, and suggest that, okay, this is an idea that I want to try out for GSOC. What do you think? So you talk about. You just talk about the basics. What is the feature you want to add? What is the things you want to change? And then why you want to do it? And why do you think it is a good GSOC idea, right? So once you get those things in the mail, you send it to them. And then most of the maintainers and the people who've already contributed would tell you whether it is a good idea and whether it should be a part of your proposal. So that is one thing. So you can, if they say it's not in the scope of their project or let's say it is something they're not looking for in the near future, you have to pick up another idea or another organization, of course, because then submitting a proposal won't do anything for you because they've already told you that idea is not useful for them. But yeah, most projects, most proposals come from the ideas list of every organization. And if you have a separate idea, of course, go ahead and tell them what your idea is. If they're okay with it, then submit a proposal. That actually might give you an edge, because when you submit a proposal for your own idea, there is less people to compete with, right? So no, there won't be two or three proposals for the same project that the maintainer has to select from, right? So in that case, if that project is good enough, your proposal is the only one, and then there's a high chance you get selected. But most cases, an organization will have, let's say, 5 to 10 ideas, and not every idea will have a proposal. So if you think you're interested in it, go for it, right? So that's how your idea submission, proposal submission stage works. But most of the work, again, will be based on repositories that already exist, projects that are already mature, and ideas that are already available on the website of the organizations that are participating in GSOC.
Okay, so like once you cleared after second year, so why did you thought of doing GSOC again after third year? Because most of the students think like in fourth year, they will be preparing in the summer holidays for placement, and like they will be focusing on data success and algorithm. So how did you manage a data success and algorithm placement preparation as well as contributed to the open source project?
Okay, so second year after my project was done, GSOC applications came up for the next year. I initially thought of, because GSOC does not require you to sit down whole day every day in the summer and code, right? So my initial thought process was I would participate in another organization, contribute to another organization's repository. But then in the last few days, I had already submitted a proposal for another organization, and they were already reviewing it. I was in the process of discussing it with the mentor in that organization. But in the last few days, the same organization I had participated in the second year, Free Type, they came up with another GSOC idea that I actually got very interested in. So it was basically implementing support. So Free Type is basically a software that renders your font on the display, right? It is a font management very core repository that runs on all Linux platforms, even your Android phone. It renders font on your display, right? Along with a few other programs in the stack, but I won't talk about them. So they came up with a good idea of implementing allowing Free Type to parse another font format. That is basically a compressed format that is used over the web. So if you are into development, web development, you would have seen WOFF2, WOFF2 format. So this is the font format that was not supported on Free Type as of yet, and that came up as a GSOC idea to add support for that format to Free Type. So this idea, actually, I got interested in that idea very much. So I discussed with the mentors and I submitted a proposal for it, and turns out that I got accepted for the project. And I already had contributed to Free Type in the past year, so I had an idea around how the repository works. So that actually gave me some advantage and saved me some time as to figuring out how things are, where things are, how to build the whole repository. And actually, interestingly, I also interned at Commvault while I was doing that GSOC project.
Okay.
So my interview for Commvault had already happened before all the GSOC stuff was done. It was in the previous year, and I was already selected for the internship. So I was actually conflicted about whether I will be able to do both of these things together, and also, like you said, prepare for the placement stuff. So what I decided was, let's go for it, because GSOC, other than the fact that your profile stands out because of GSOC, I got to contribute to a software that today runs, that was already running on billions of devices, and I can now feel proud about the fact that the code that I wrote now runs on billions and billions of Linux and Android devices. Right, so that is the motivation behind why I decided to participate and continue with that project while working on my internship side by side. Right. As to your question as of why, how I prepared the algorithms and data structures for the campus placements. So if you look at my GSOC project, the code that I've written, it involves a lot of different data structures I had to use, and it's in the C language. Mm-hmm. So being a core language, you don't have all these utility libraries available that you can just say import and then use a tree, or import and then use a graph. So you have to write those things from scratch, right? So turns out writing code for a real software that works on so many computers that you have to continuously optimize to ensure gives performance, that is somewhat of an equal equal way to gain knowledge as you're going through a textbook and learning those data structures yourself. So working on that project actually gave me a lot of boost for the campus placement interviews that came in the next academic year after that.
And GSOC adds the value to the CV also.
So I did my first, after I did my first GSOC and my internship at Commvault, I got selected. My resume actually people remembered about my resume. So I had a few people come and tell me that you have an impressive profile. So that is a very good boost. So because people now have some kind of a trust, saying that okay, you have worked with real code, and you've worked with a team, and you know how to navigate through your stuff, right? Because you've already completed GSOC, and when people, even if they don't know about it, they look it up, and of course, being associated with Google gives you a boost. So even if people don't know about it, they're like, okay, fine, it's a Google sponsored program, and you've worked on it, and that gives you a lot of credibility for your interviews, and gives your resume a boost when you're submitting it for Java applications online, or when people are reading through it in an interview.
Yeah, so like one student have one question, like what are the chances of plagiarism or stealing of proposals?
Right, so in GSOC, many organizations in GSOC ask students to post their proposals publicly. So there is no point of plagiarism there, because if you copy and paste another person's proposal, you're obviously immediately disqualified, because everyone else has seen the other student's proposal, which you have directly copied from. Many organizations prefer to keep your proposals private. So you develop your proposals in private, send the mentor the link to your proposal, and then they will usually comment it and review it and tell you things to add or remove or modify, right? So plagiarism is not a very big part of your GSOC proposal, because usually the projects that you are proposing to do have not been done before. So your proposal will not be checked for plagiarism as such. But what is important is, if there are multiple people contributing, like submitting a proposal for the same project, you need to make sure that your proposal is something the organization mentors can look at and say, okay, this guy looks like someone who has clear ideas about what to do about this project. So that's how you make your proposal stand out. So don't go too much into plagiarism, because if there are multiple people submitting a proposal for the same project, of course, so many words, so many terminologies, so many objectives will be same, but that does not stop you from making a proposal stand out with clear objectives and clear timelines for your project, right?
So according to next year, now anyone can apply for GSOC if he's from industry or from college, and the stipend has also reduced to just half for Indians. So according to you, the credibility will be decreased of GSOC or not, and other competition will also be increased now.
Right. So I think the eligibility was only changed to include non-students who passed out in the last 6 months, I think. Right. So that doesn't widen the gap too much. So there won't be veteran industry people participating in GSOC, because most of them are passed out too many years ago to be able to participate. Right. So the reason the stipend was reduced to half is because the GSOC duration, the timeline actually was also cut down to half. So it's not, I think it won't affect the credibility. Of course, it will change the scope of the projects, because many of the projects that required 3.5 months to complete will now not be possible in the GSOC timeline. So the scope of the projects will definitely be reduced, but I doubt the credibility will be affected in any way, because the fact that you're participating in GSOC means you're contributing code to a repository that is already in production. You're communicating with a whole team that is contributing to the same repository. So in that process, you're improving your communication skills, you're improving your programming skills, you're improving your data structures and algorithms knowledge. So that remains the same. Don't worry too much about the stipend. So I mean, I think we still get a $1,500 of a stipend probably, and that should be good enough for the 10 weeks you'll be working, 10 to 12 weeks you'll be working for GSOC, right?
So
I don't think the credibility will change as such. And about the competition, it won't be too much. There will be some people who just passed out from the fourth year who will be trying to participate, but don't worry too much about it. If your proposal, what you have to focus on is that you want to get the proposal for your project stand out, and you want to be able to have a past communication with the community so that they can trust your proposal to be what it actually says it is, right?
And one of our senior Vinit Bhaiya has asked, like, tips for third year students looking for internship and strengthening DSA concepts.
Right. So third year, I guess you would have started third year right now.
I'm currently in second year.
The guy who asked the question.
He's in sixth semester.
Right. So sixth semester, you have a lot of time to, and I guess you, most of you, all of you guys are at home. So you have a lot of time to solve problems, study algorithms. So whatever works best for you. So that you could be a guy who learns by solving the problem, or you could be someone who learns by reading a book and then going on to implement, or writing code on the paper and then trying to implement it on your IDE or whatever, which actually brings me to your interview process, right? Many of these interview people will ask you to write code on paper. So that actually is a different set of skills, slightly different than how you write code on IDE, because on an IDE you have continuous suggestions telling you to let's say if the variable name is wrong, or if you messed up a loop somewhere, your IDE will mostly detect it for you and tell it to you. But while you're writing code on paper, you have to take care of a lot of things that, because you don't have any suggestions as such. So what an interviewer will see is not your syntax, but they will see if your program is going in the correct logic, right? So that is also a small part of it. Try pick up a few questions, try writing it on paper, see how it goes. That's it. So I'm not saying you to write all your code on paper. Just try it out. Be ready for an interview in that case. And so if you're already in the sixth semester, I would say, depending on your current knowledge, like depending on how much you have a knowledge about your data structures, algorithms, and how many programming languages you know, I would suggest go online, start solving problems as much as you can. Start learning how to think about approaching a problem, right? An interviewer won't care if you don't reach the most optimal solution, right? Even if, let's say, the optimal solution is n log n, and you are able to do it in n log squared n, the interviewer doesn't care about that small gap. What they want to know is how you start, how you approach to your most optimal solution, and how you're able to get there, and how your thinking process. So you have to think out loud, right? In an interview, you should be able to think out loud. You should be able to talk to them. You should be able to ask questions. So most of the times, these questions aren't very clear. So they'll just tell you there is a party. You want to calculate something something about the people in that party. So you have to go back and forth. So like, how many people are in the party? How do I know what properties these people have in the party? Just giving an example. So you have to go back and forth. You want to be able to think out loud of how you're approaching the problem. And again, practice is the most important for solving problems, and try to get mock interviews with your friends. So one of you can be the interviewer, one of you can prepare questions for the others. So go to any website, pick up any interview problems and ask each other, right? And see how you react in that limited time, and how you react to a question that you've never seen before, how you approach that question. So that will actually help a lot. So yeah, I guess you have a lot of time. I mean, probably next semester, seventh semester, you will start your interviews, if not this semester. But yeah, try attending as, even if you don't like a company. So let's say it's you want to go into a product-based company and you have a service-based company coming in. Don't think about, okay, I'm not going to attend this interview because it's not a company I aim to be in. Just go for the interview, see how it goes. That actually gives you confidence. So it will build up your confidence in front of an interviewer or a panel of interviewers who are sitting in front of you and looking at you and continuously expecting something out of you, right? So that will improve your confidence. And when you actually sit down for an interview of a company that you are interested in, you will have some of that confidence from those previous interviews, and then you'll be you'll have that advantage over the people who are attending that interview, same interview for the first time.
Okay, so like, what is the importance given in the placement interviews of work experience and projects?
Okay, so many of these technical interviews that you will attend, they will ask you about your previous projects or your work experience. So in case of internship or your first job, your work experience will be minimal. Probably it could also be zero, which is not a bad thing, of course. But in that case, your projects will be a point of discussion many of the times. So let's say in case you have done, let's say you're in the seventh semester, you're sitting in an interview, you have done multiple projects. So I think many of you guys are doing one project at least every semester. That is how our curriculum is set up. So that allows you to highlight those, the best of those projects in your resume, right? And make sure you build your, when you build your resume, you put information that you can immediately answer about, right? So you don't want to write anything fancy about machine learning or AI if, let's say, you haven't contributed to such a project on a scale where you know about the project, right? You should at least be able to answer any questions that the interviewer has for you about the project. So many of these interviewers will ask you about those projects. They will talk about, they will also talk about how you collaborated with your team members and how you resolved conflicts. So there is one example from an Amazon interview that I had. So these people have something called a behavioral interview, right? So in this interview, they will talk to you about your projects, and they will talk to you about, for example, how if you had a conflict with a team member about how something should be done, and how did you resolve that conflict, right? So that is one aspect you should keep in mind. So think about what are the conflicts, think about what are the challenges you faced during when you did this, these projects, think about how you could have improved these projects, or how you could have taken a different path if you had more time and improved these projects, right? So if you're adding those to your resume, just keep those things in mind so that you're able to answer to the interviewer when they ask you these questions, right? And work experience. So in our case, your work experience could be an internship you did in the previous years during the summer. Or again, it could be a program like GSOC, right? So you have many other programs like GSOC that are going on. So you could have participated in any of those, which are also very prestigious, and they give a highlight to your resume, right? So in that case, they will ask you about what this program is. Many people actually are not aware in the industry of what GSOC and equivalent programs are. So you should explain what GSOC is and how you collaborated with a team to work on a project over 12 weeks to complete a set of tasks that you proposed to do in the beginning of the project. And you can also highlight this by, let's say, telling how many students applied and how many got selected. That also gives you a highlight, saying, okay, this person is capable of preparing documents that is highlighted among these many people, and so that will give you a boost right there also, right? So again, your projects, they are important. Include only those projects in your resume that you know about well enough to answer questions that the interviewer has for you. And definitely include all experience you have in your resume, so that gives some confidence to the interviewer that you have worked in a team, that you know how coding or programming or development or architecting software in the real world works.
Okay, so Bhaiya, could you please share your interview experience with Commvault or other companies which came to the university?
Yeah, so I didn't interview with a lot of companies because Commvault came pretty early on. And I had already gotten the interview, right? So I'll talk about my interview at Commvault. So we had multiple stages for the process. So the first one was a online test that was conducted in our university itself, right? So once we cleared the online test, so the test involved a couple MCQs about your core knowledge of OS networks and a few other things. And after that test, we had another programming test, which involved three or four questions, as far as I remember. And you had the option of coding it in C++ or Java. Right. So Python was not an option when I interviewed, when I gave the test, but I think they added it later. So you might see Python if Commvault comes to campus for your interviews. Right. Make sure you know one of C++ or Java for interviews, because many interviewers do expect for their coding tests for you to know C++ or Java. I think you are doing Java as one of the courses in one of the semesters.
Java also, and now C++ also.
Oh, great. Both are covered. That is good, because C++ gives you a more in-depth knowledge of your core OS related kernel APIs and your pointers and things like that. That is a good thing. So make sure you know one of those languages. So in my case, I already had knowledge of C++ because I had been practicing competitive coding questions on CodeChef and other platforms. So if you guys don't know, I was part of the CodeChef campus chapter team. In campus also. So I did my test in C++, and once I cleared that round, so I guess around 20 people cleared that round for the next round. So the next round now was a on-site coding coding round, where you had a few questions depending. So we had two profiles. So there was this SDET, which is testing profile, and the SDE profile, which is the development profile. So the SDETs had a separate test, the SDE had a separate test. So SDETs were given Python problems to solve, and the SDEs were given Java problems to solve, mainly because Commvault does a lot of Java and C++ development in their development side, right? And SDET side use a lot of Python to build your testing, your SDKs, and a lot of other tools that are used around our software, right? So because I went for the SDE test, which was in Java. So they gave us a single problem that lasted for, I think, 4 or 5 hours. So in this round, actually, it was more of a discussion and implementation round. So we were given 1 hour to think about how we will implement the problem, the kind of approach we will have to the problem. And then the mentor, of course, these were guys who came from Commvault, and they were taking the round, right? So they were conducting the round. So you had to discuss with one of those mentors and talk to them about how you plan to implement your solution. And then they actually give you ideas. So it's not like you tell them and then you're done, you continue implementing. They give you ideas. Maybe you could do this. And then you're like, right, you're right. Maybe I could do this. Maybe I could improve this in this way. And then once you're done discussing, they give you the rest of the time to actually code it out in whatever language, C++ or Java you prefer, right? So once that is done, the last half an hour was dedicated to the same mentor sitting with you and running the program, and then looking at your code, seeing how closely your initial approach and how your actual code match, and if you made any changes, why you made them, and why you took that approach. So it was a very discussion oriented session, which I felt was good. Many companies don't do this, but Commvault most usually does this. They will ask you to implement one problem, they will discuss with you your approach, and then they will discuss in detail with you your solution, which allows you to actually improve yourself in the process, even if you end up not getting selected, right? So after the coding round, for SDE, three of us got selected for the interview round. So this was a very extensive process, you would think, at least for an internship, but that is how Commvault works. So if you come in for an internship, they want to keep you. They didn't hire you for 3 months and then let you go, right? If they take you, they want to keep you. So they want to convert you to a full time. So that's why these internship interviews, these processes are longer than most other companies, right? So this interview round for me lasted for more than 1 hour, I think, right? So don't be intimidated by long interviews, because how it went for me, because it wasn't a one-sided thing where the interviewers, so there were two of them, they ask me questions and then I keep answering them or tell them I don't know, and then they throw the next question at me. So it was more of a discussion like thing. So the interviewer started with a simple problem. First, we actually discussed more on the solution I implemented in the previous round, right? So we talked about how we could improve it. We talked about how we could optimize those data structures that I used to improve the algorithmic complexity of the solution and all. But those were just a very, very nice discussion back and forth between the interviewer and me. So after this, the interviewer started with basic network question. I think he started with the network question, asked me to explain how, when you type in a URL on the browser, how does it load the page? So he wanted me to explain through the network stack. He told me to choose any stack. It could be the OSI or the actual networking stack that we have today. He wanted me to explain how each packet goes through the stack, and then how at each hop it goes back up to a few layers, and then the packet goes back to the next destination. So that's how he wanted me to explain how the packet reaches the server, and then how the web page is delivered back to you. So that was one question. And then I had the longest question, I think, was an OS question. It was a multi processor programming like question. I'll get to that later. One of the questions was basically a tree question. So it was an algorithm to check if a tree was balanced, as far as I remember. So he asked me to write out the pseudocode on paper. So that is when I realized that I was not good at writing code on paper, right? And the interviewer himself asked me whether I had written code before on paper, and I was like, no, I don't do this usually. I have this habit of writing code on an IDE and then running it continuously and then checking if it works and then figuring out what went wrong, right? So that's when I realized that actually coming up with a solution and writing it on paper gives you an edge in interviews, right? So So after discussing the algorithm with the interviewer back and forth, I was able to code up the algorithm in, I think it was Java, on the paper. And then next we moved on to a few OS questions that were very, very, very basic. And then he asked me to write an SQL query given a few tables. I had to do a few joins and then get out of result that he asked me to get, right? And then the final question, okay, I think, was a way. We were discussing a way to sort an array that was larger than the memory of a computer, right? So you have this huge array that is larger than you can fit in the RAM of a computer, but we want to sort it, right? So we went back and forth discussing how you can put those ideas of the sorts we already know to an array that cannot be completely fit in memory. So we discussed ideas like merge sort, how we can bring those numbers in batches, array in batches into the memory, and then sort them, and then do multiple rounds of those. And then that's how we finally arrived at a solution. And then one important thing I remember is that the interviewer actually asked me the time complexity and space complexity of most of the questions that we discussed. So that is one important thing you should focus on a little, because when you solve a problem, you should be able to figure out how long it will take to solve it and how much space it will take to solve it. Because many systems that you build in real life have some constraints. Like if it's an API, let's say, you want to respond within a second so that like the API doesn't time out, right? Or let's say if you're running your code on a microprocessor, you want to be able to make sure that it doesn't take up more than 1 KB of RAM. Right. So these are some restrictions that are actually coming when you work on real life code. So you should be able to figure out your time complexity and space complexity for any algorithm that you yourself are writing, and which should not be very hard once you're done with the algorithms course. Even if you haven't, go on YouTube, look it up, look up how time complexity and space complexity works. It's not very hard to know, but it is very good to know. Right. So that's my interview experience. After the interview was done, I think on the same day, the next hour, we were announced the results, and we were told that two of us were selected for the SDE profile, the SDE internship, and four of my friends were selected for the SDET profile. And we went on to Hyderabad in the coming summer for the internship. And actually, I think out of the six of us, five of us are now working full time for Commvault. So that's been a good experience for us. Yeah.
Yeah. So like that was pretty good to hear. And like it would have been not good for those like who attempted and went to the final round. And like after 4 or 5 hours or of they are rejected and like they have to sit in the interview next day also. Like it would be have been a tiring day for all of them.
Yes. So of course. So if you are going for a job interview, there are chances that you will not be selected due to many reasons. It could be a number limitation where they cannot take in more than these many students, or there could be some student that perform better than you for one question, maybe that he already knew an answer to and you probably couldn't figure it out. So there are many factors. It could also be that your day is not just going fine, you weren't in the mood, or you weren't feeling good about your interview, things like that. So these things keep happening. I would say is that once you're done with the interview, of course you take your time, you of course each one of us will feel bad about it. You take your time, take a few days, come out of it, and then you see what you can learn out of the interview or all the stages you went through. If you think about it, there'll be a few obvious things that you can point out that you need to improve in yourself before sitting for the next interview, right? So it could be that you, when you sit in front of an interviewer, you get so nervous that you're not, even if you know how to approach a problem, you're not able to get to a solution because you think, oh my God, these people are looking at me, there's less time, there's 5 minutes, I can't write code on paper, things like that, right? So if you think that is the case, just again, like I told you, sit down with a friend, do a mock interview, and that could be one thing. And if you think, let's say, you couldn't clear the coding round, the previous rounds where you want to code questions and that they are auto checked by the system, so you're not able to do that. You can go on CodeChef, you can go on Geek for Geeks, where they have automatic checking for your questions. So the system, when you write the code, the system gives test input and it checks it against their the actual outputs that the program should give, right? Many people I have seen that they have not practiced any of this, and then they get stuck there because they probably print things like enter a number. So a system that is automatically checking your code will fail your code immediately if it gives any output other than what it is expecting. So right, so these are the things you should know. Of course, after a few days, if you, let's say, get rejected in an interview, after a few days, think about it, think of the things you can improve, and try to improve on those things as much as you can before you sit for the next interview, right? It's not like if Facebook rejected you once, you're not going to be able to be applying for Facebook in the next year, right? If you have a dream company, if you have, let's say, Google, right? If Google rejected you today, it's not like you can't go for a Google interview in the next 6 months or in the next year. And the best part is that in the next year, you will have more experience, you will have more knowledge. So there is a higher chance that you get selected for that interview, right? So don't get too depressed. Don't worry about not being selected into one of those top five or four companies. They are of course prestigious. They are like a dream for many people to get into, but you can always start wherever you are and then build your knowledge to get to probably a better position in that company than you would have if you went out of campus recruitments, right? So if you work at another product company, you reach to the senior engineer level, and then you apply for a job at one of those dream companies of yours, and then you get selected, you probably have much better package, have a more competitive position, and you probably have a better standing in that industry once you enter that company.
Okay, so like that was very nice to hear all the experience and take guidance and interact with you. Now we are open to questions for the next 5 minutes. So Aditya, you can unmute everyone and like they can raise their hands and we can take 2-3 questions. Yeah, I guess now, like Madhvik, you can open your unmute yourself.
भैया आपने कोड शेव करना किस ईयर से स्टार्ट करा था?
I started CodeShift before joining the college actually. So 12th, after 12th, we have this long summer vacation, right? So that's where I got into starting CodeShift. I started solving problems in the most basic section, and that's how I went into it. But
CodeShift में questions ऐसे करने की कोशिश करता हूँ, मेरे को तो बहुत ज़्यादा time लगता है, even तो मैंने C++ पढ़ी हुई है.
See, huh? Again, C++ is not and should not be a benchmark for how you're able to solve the questions. But yeah, initially it will take time to figure out how you want to approach a problem and to be within those time limits of, let's say, 1 second or 0.5 seconds. But as you keep on solving problems, you will build a collection of algorithms and data structures that you have in your mind that you know that, okay, this is a new problem. These are the few things I can collect and use to solve this problem. So don't worry if you're taking time. It's just part of the process. Eventually, you will be able to solve those problems.
And the 2 years you did GSOC, आपको कितना stipend मिला था अगर मिला था?
Okay. So second year, I think the stipend was $2,400, and they increased it in the next year to $3,000. So that was
second year 2400. Yeah. ये तो अच्छा है.
Yeah.
But from next year you will be getting only $1,000 or $1,500.
$1,500.
So don't think of, so don't think of a stipend. See the work experience which you are getting from the organization.
Yeah, and don't worry, it's not that they've reduced the stipend. They've also reduced the time of the program. So you're not getting paid less for your work, right? So that's not an issue.
Manohar bhaiya, you can unmute yourself.
Hi Nikhil bhaiya.
Hi Manohar. Hi.
So the thing is, what are the topics? As like we know, that data structures, mein there are a plethora of things, right? Algorithm.
Right.
So what are the things ki, you need to know till trees, or you need to know till this X Y topic for being comfortable in for these interviews? And second part is, main Vineet ka question bhi combine kar deta hu. So like there are subjects, right? OS hai, CN hai, and all these are these subjects. So how, what do we need to learn from these things, from like these subjects, OS and kya topics, data structures and algorithms, mein, which are important for interviews.
Right. So data structures, I think it totally depends from person to person, how much you have to practice to be comfortable with it. So for example, for me, how it works is, if I look at a data structure, I'm like, okay, fine, let me do a few problems. I start the problems. At first, I'm completely clueless of how to solve the problem. I look it up online. I find out algorithms, how to do it, how other people have done it. And then, okay, I've solved one problem, and then I move to the next problem. And then I try to solve it with whatever I understood from the previous problem. And again, if I can't solve it, I look it up, I look at the solution, see how it's done. And then eventually that builds up an approach to that data structure. So like you asked, how many data structures you should know? I'd say it doesn't matter, because there are a plethora of data structures that exist that we don't even probably know the names of all of them, right? But there are some data structures like arrays, trees, graphs, some of graphs. Yeah, no, I mean, you don't have, graphs is a very vast topic. You won't be expected to know all graph related algorithms or how all kinds of graphs work. But yeah, some of graphs, some of the basic algorithms like BFS, right, DFS, things like that. Queues and stack are very important, because from an operating system level, queues and stacks are used to perform many operations, so you should be knowing those. And once you have an idea of how these data structures work, I would suggest you to look at where these data structures are actually used, right? So today, if a professor tells you what a tree is, you will understand that there is a root, there are children to it, there are children to those roots, right? And then you will talk about binary search tree where you have always the left one is smaller, the right one is greater. But then when you actually think about it, the professor told you what it is, but you have no idea of where it is actually used, right? If you can think of one, obviously that is great, that is awesome. But go online, look at what these data structures are used for, right? So for example, stack. If you look at stack, it is a very core data structure. So when you're programming, so when you code something in a programming language and that program is running, you have this function call stack, right? So that is a call stack of a of those functions that are being called while your programming is running. So it comes at a very core level of your compiler and your OS, right? So once you appreciate like what the real use of the data structure is, you will start understanding where it is used, and you will also get an idea of how you yourself can use it to solve problems, right? So if there's this, like I told you about the stack, so it is used for function call stack. So similarly, if you want to do a program where you want to keep track of where someone is going and then you want to be able to trace back, right? So there you know, okay, fine, a stack will be a good option to use rather than using something else like a queue or an array, because it allows you to go back in order, right? So it depends on you. Go with the basic data structures that are expected of you. Like I told you, trees, arrays, graphs, stacks, and queues, right? I'm sorry if I missed something, but yeah. So I know a few algorithms and try to solve a few questions that are based on these algorithms. So not just the algorithms, try to solve interesting questions based on these algorithms. That's where your coding platforms come in, right? So they have a very nice way of framing those questions. Like, they have real world questions. Like someone is playing a game, they want to win the highest number of points. How do you do it? How do you do it? Right. So that's one way to get interested in data structures, even if you think, oh, these things are so boring, right?
Okay, that was. Yeah, Manas, we can take one or two questions more, and then we can wrap
yes. up the site. Hi, Nikhil.
Yeah. Hi.
Please advise one thing I should do and I shouldn't do coming into Bennett as a fresher with no coding experience in the past.
Okay. So I'm guessing you don't have coding experience because you didn't have a computer. I mean, computer science is a subject previously, right? So you're starting
yes,
out.
Yes, I haven't done any coding like to date.
Okay, so you'd be learning Python, right?
Yes.
Okay, so I would say go first semester, go with whatever they're teaching you, go with trying to understand how whatever they're teaching you works, because by the time you reach the end of the semester, you would have learned a lot of concepts through Python. You would have learned a lot of computer science concepts. So you basically are learning how to talk to a computer, right? So once you have those things with you, you can probably in the small vacation you have after that, or even if you want immediately, you can start looking at beginner problems or beginner questions on competitive programming platforms. If you're not interested in competitive coding, sure, try to explore projects on GitHub that you can contribute to. Simple projects, like things like simple programs to do a single task, right? Go there, try to contribute. It could be a Python project also. That is an advantage because you already know Python, right? Okay. Do that, see how it turns out, and see if it actually brings interest in you. It is completely possible that you're not interested in coding at all. That's also okay, right? You, as a computer science engineer, you are expected to know some coding, but it's not necessary that you have to spend your life doing coding, or you always have to find a coding job in the future, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
And one more thing. Yeah. How much do clubs contribute to your career after 4 years? Working with the clubs, different clubs.
Are you talking about the technical clubs or the other ones, like the non-technical stuff?
If you could just, tell in general ki matlab
right,
clubs.
Right. Okay. So one thing I would advise everyone is don't study too much, right? I mean, you have been doing that for the last 12 years. I know how competitive JEE is. I know how many expectations people have from our 12th results. So this is a time for you to focus on academics, but also to do other things that you are interested in, right? That very less people are there who are only interested in academics, right? So if there is a club you think you will be interested in joining, so it could be things like your drama club, your music club, if you're interested in singing, if you're interested in let's say art, you can join the art club, whatever. Do those things. Don't study too much, and they will definitely contribute to your overall development. If you keep doing academics, I hardly think you will build people skills. I hardly think you will be able to actually function in a organization whenever you get a job. So don't give up on the clubs. Don't study too much. Of course, focus on your academics, focus on your goals, set a goal. So if you let's say I want at least one A this semester, focus on that. Use your strengths to get that A. And other than that, do things that you like, right? That's what I would say.
आपने क्या lecture
Thank slide you.
Lecture slide और PPTs के अलावा textbooks भी पढ़ी थी अलग से जो recommend कर रहे हैं वो?
First semester में I think I had gotten a few textbooks. Because especially for maths you need to solve a lot of problems, because college maths is slightly different from your school mathematics. So I practiced problems from the textbooks, and I'm not very good at electronics, so I had to get the book and read a lot to actually get a hold of what is happening. So that was one thing. But yeah, after that, after the first year, most resources I needed were online. So any courses I needed were available on your Udacity, Coursera, things like that. And any resources I needed were also available online. So if you think you're comfortable with learning from a textbook, go ahead and get a textbook. Try to learn online, try to learn from online resources, videos. If you think you can do it, go ahead and do it. So it all depends on what you're comfortable with, but don't force yourself to get a textbook and then it's just lying on one side doing nothing. So that's just waste of money and paper, right?
Yeah, Tarun, you can ask last question and then another questions we can take up from the next session because it's now 8:15. Tarun, you can ask.
Yeah, hello Nikhil bhaiya.
Hi Tarun.
Yeah, bhaiya, I had just one doubt. How much dependent can we on college and the placement cells for internships and our fourth year placements?
Right. So Commvault, the organization I'm working in right now, they came for campus placements. So that is one good company that you can look forward to, right? Other than that, there are a lot of companies coming in. I believe if you are interested in building a lot of diverse software, we have TCS, we have Capgemini. These companies build a lot of different software for a lot of different clients. So if you're interested in gaining that kind of an experience, you can look forward to those companies. But I would say that don't just depend completely on the campus placements for your for whatever your goals are, right? We have, especially now, many companies are hiring remote. So even if the company you're looking for is in a location, let's say, where you don't want to move or is out of the country, apply for it, build a resume, write down your strengths, write down your experiences, write down about your projects, upload your resume and see where it goes, right? Nothing wrong is going to happen. What's the worst? You will be rejected. That's fine. But you at least you explore other options. You don't want to have that regret later saying that I waited for campus placements and I couldn't get anything. So I would say apply online. Apply as much as you can. Find organizations that fit your goals, fit your interest, and apply to them. But yes, participate actively in campus placements. They will allow you, even if you're not interested in the organization, they will allow you to build a lot of person-to-person, like face-to-face interview experience as much as possible, right?
Okay, so that was good to hear, Bhaiya. Thank you for joining, Bhaiya, giving us your valuable time. Any last-minute advice which you want to give to the third year rights who will be sitting for placement of fourth year rights?
So yeah, so third years, I know this is a very very different time, but a very difficult time for a lot of people. It could be difficult for you to participate in interviews because it is a different process right now. It's not face to face. Many of the things will happen online. You will face difficulties, but try to get adjusted to it. Don't worry too much. I mean, I'm sure we'll pull through whatever is happening in the next year or whenever it is. But yeah, try to get used to this remote way of working. I am working remote. Most of the companies out there are working remote, especially all the software jobs are now going fully remote, at least till the next year. And even after next year, I suspect that this is going to be the norm. Many software jobs will continue working remote. Many companies will not ask you to come to their location. They will not. They would prefer to save office space, save paying all that electricity bill. And then they will tell you to sit at home, do your work. And it is a different experience. Try to get used to it. Apply to as many companies you think reflect your goals, reflected aspirations, and where you think your growth will be good. Of course, placement is not the only way to move forward. You can also be looking for masters in a university in India or abroad. If you are doing that, look towards your goals. Look at how you'll be giving GRE and how you'll be applying to universities after your fourth year is done. And go ahead based on whatever you're thinking. So don't worry too much about the situation. Remote working is going to be the norm. We all have to get used to it. And for the freshers, again, I would like to say, focus on academics, but don't get too much into it. Focus on academics, set a goal, keep reaching that goal, keep trying to increase those goals every semester, try to achieve them, and don't get all into academics like, okay, I want a 10 GPA every semester. That probably won't happen, and that is not healthy. Like, to be very honest, trying to get a 10 GPA every semester is not healthy, right? Once, let's say computer science is of a very high interest to you, so once you get those courses where you excel, you will definitely get an A+ grade or whatever grade is the best, right? But don't get too much into it. Set a goal, follow that. Also participate in your favorite clubs. Also participate in college events. Also participate in cultural events, right? That will help you build your people skills. So it's not just having fun here and there. It also helps you build your people skills. It also helps you build your public speaking skills. And it also helps you build a network. So if you're hosting a cultural event in college, you have to talk to a lot of people outside college. You have to talk to a lot of companies outside college. That helps you build a network. So when time comes for you to look for an internship, you can actually reach out to those networks, seeking out for internships, and they probably will give you a position. So that is something you can look forward to if you are participating in a lot of these extracurricular activities, right? So that's for the freshers. Third years and fourth years, buckle up. Just let's get used to this remote working environment. And that's it. So all the best for your interviews, and first years freshers, all the best. I hope you guys are able to enjoy the campus life very soon.
Okay, so thank you, Bhaiya, for joining.
Thanks for having me. The questions were very good, actually, and it also helped me think about a few things that I should be doing, because once you get a job, it's not enough. You still need to be up to date with the technologies. You still need to be up to date with your problem solving approach and things like that. So thanks, guys. You were a great audience. I specialized in cryptography and security.
Okay, so thank you very much for joining.
How can we contact you if we need, if we want to ask something?
You can mail me on my Bennett ID. So it's nikhil.ramakrishnan@bennett.edu.in, right?
Okay.
If that is not reachable, I will send Daksh my alternate email ID. He will share it with you guys, right?
Okay, I will share in the group once. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Bea. Guys, you can now leave the meeting. Thank you for joining, everyone.